Now, I'm going to jump to the character discussion because this is my system. There are lots of systems, and you know, there's a joke that if you want a really horrible film, put three producers in the room because they all have a great film and they're all going to get in there. And I've done that. I've done co-productions, and everybody blames international co-productions for being unsuccessful because of cultural reasons. Yeah. I would just say, hey, it's ego. But okay, this is a system that is not rigid, but it works for me. In any story or documentary, you're going to have various people that help you tell the story. One goal for most documentarians is to have the least amount of narration possible. That's a little tough when you're telling something that's 200 years old. You know, you're going to end up with authors and narrators. But that's okay. You still can follow this system. An A character is a primary voice in the doc, in the story. If you're lucky, like that one, or some other ones that you could see on that, they might have been there, involved, an actual, you know, not necessarily a witness, I'm sorry, I'm going to use that word later, but, you know, actually somehow it's their story in some way. Sometimes that's much more right down the thing. I have one on, I don't know if you know the City of Yuma flight story, where these two guys in 1951, I think it was, decided they were going to pull the air base out of Yuma. And I said, oh, how are we going to save this? You know, this is going to really wreck the town. So these two guys decided to take a plane up and try to break the flight endurance record, the international flight. And they flew around in circles. Three failures, finally got up there, and they did it. They did, I don't know how many, it was like 10,000 hours. And they would they would refuel it, and I have that story, but they would refuel it by driving a 1952 Dodge or something right next to it, convertible, and then hand up fuel tank and food and, you know, little baggies and stuff, and there's a whole scene about that. Everybody asks us what we did with that, you know? That's what the guy said. He said, we, of course, went over the California border. True Arizona. But they got so lucky because there was film, there were photographs, and they were all alive. And they had found the plane, which had gone to like Minnesota, and they bought it, and they brought it back and restored it. And guess what? There's still an air base there. So I was going to show you that, but there's no conflict there. Well, the conflict is, can they make it? But it wasn't a debate-oriented story. But those people were directly involved. So if you can find that, fine. But with history, sometimes it's a really passionate author or historian, you know, that is your primary source. They have a glint in their eye that they care. They weren't there because they're not 135, but they can still tell that story, and they pop up several places. Your B characters may be also historians or authors or a relative or somebody that is tangentially part of the story and can deliver bits where you need it. The guy that oversees the dam and has for 30 years, but wasn't there when they built it. He's not gonna help you tell the building story, but he loves the dam, the Glen Canyon, and he's gonna say, you know, this is the heart of our community. We look at this dam, and this is, you know, which is true because Page wasn't there before they built the dam. So he gives you, and he can come at the end and say, you know, there are two sides to this story, but, you know, for us, it's still important. So this gets a little vague. So he's a secondary voice that can come in a couple of times and help you tell parts, but not the whole story. And then lastly would be a C character. Sometimes you need him, sometimes you don't. That's the guy that you just happened to find that, you know, pushed the thing that blew up the first rock to build the dam. And then he went home. But you found him, and you're thinking, you know, here I have this film of the rock blowing up and all this stuff. You know, it might be fun to have someone come in and say, yeah, I remember that day. It was really loud. Do you have anything else to say? No. You're a C character. Thank you very much. But it gives you a nice little, you know, bright moment, and they only enter one scene. There's a film we just watched on kids in India. They're born into brothels, actually. And so my students, on their midterm, I asked them, tell me about A, Bs, and Cs, and give me examples from the docs we watched. And all of them chose the same one, where there's a guy, they were trying to get one of the kids who turned out to be, they were training them how to be photographers, really good, and he was wanted to go to this show in Amsterdam and display his photographs, and they couldn't get a visa. So the visa guy, which they went back three times during one scene, became a C character. He was absolutely necessary. He had nothing to do with this kid's life except for right then. But to get him in there, and he finally goes, gee. So it's not necessarily a level of importance, because that scene without that guy is, again, fairly boring. But he doesn't tell the story. So think about when you're thinking about the characters or your storytellers, that's just a way to kind of structure them. And I will tell you, you will go out and do what you think is your A and find out that your B becomes your A. I mean, I went out and did Sinking the Lusitania. Spent a long time finding the best voice. Here's this guy that knows the whole story. He's at the Mariners Museum in Norfolk, Virginia. Flew all the way to the East Coast. They have a sister ship model about 13 feet long, beautiful, in a glass case, the Mauritania. Lit it up, put it behind him, was the best thing. It just looked so great. I cut him from the dock. He tanked. He sweated. He couldn't conjugate a verb. And believe me, I was sweating too. But he had told me that there was a guy that could tell the German side of the story up at the Smithsonian. So I thought, oh good, I'll get my B character. He can tell that. No, it turns out this guy was great. He said everything. So he suddenly became my primary. And I didn't know that until I got back. So those things are interchangeable. Don't get locked into it. I'm going to talk quickly about, and that's a way, again, to personalize it. Let them tell the story if you can. You know, I've gone into so many docs and decided I'm going to tell this with just voices. And then in the end, I end up putting narration in. You don't have to use narration as transitional devices. The other thing you can do that is really, really works well is text on screen. If you need to transition, if you need to kind of subliminally tell the people, okay, we're done with that scene, we're going on to the next one, fade to black, and then you put the proclamation. You know, January 1, 1987. Dissolve, come up, you're in a new scene. Instead of having the narrator say, then in January, but that's a whole different style, and you can't just use it once. You have to use it a couple of times so that the style of the piece hangs together. I was going to talk about music and graphics. You know, there's some graphics in there, but they're not very heavy. And I think generally, because of academia and because of you're trying to set up a real fact-based trust between the audience and the filmmaker, a lot of snazzy graphics tend to muddy that. And, you know, I've been surprised. Most of the kids I've been teaching aren't interested in that. And yet, nowadays, you have templates, and you can easily spin Mekamuff, you know. But you see, and isn't that funny? Just describing it makes you laugh. But there are appropriate places for graphics. Don't over-graphic, especially in history. They frown upon that. And then music, we used music. I've always thought, if you have to force me to feel something through music, then my writing and visuals really suck. Because you should already be feeling that. And then I put a little something under to give it an atmosphere. You know, and I think Steve did a fairly well job. He had some pretty spacey music in the middle there. I don't know if you noticed it was kind of Erps and Eeps and Brian Eno or something. But it worked because it had a sense of dilemma. You don't want to, you know, bong, bong. That's a little heavy. So choose it, keep it low, you know. Unless you're doing something really silly and fun, and you can. You know, then you can get zany music, and that tells you time to be silly.